In the Vedanta, they say the causes of human suffering are five. Human suffering. Five causes. They are called the kleshas. K-L-E-S-H-A-S. Kleshas. Sanskrit word for causes of human suffering. The first cause is not knowing the nature of reality. The second cause is grasping, clinging to something that you cannot hold on to. How do you hold on to something that comes and goes? Every experience is like that, including the experience of your body and your mind. You cannot hold on to it. This is not the same body that I had. Actually, I came to the Bahamas 2 months ago, brought the same suitcase, but not the same body. My suitcase has a longer shelf life than this thing that I say is mine, right? But what is this? It's what I'm experiencing right now as sensations, images, feelings, thoughts, which are being generated in awareness and subsiding into awareness. So the way we said body, this. So this is the second cause, is not, first cause, not knowing the true nature of reality. Second cause is grasping and clinging at an activity. You cannot hold on to an activity. You can hold on to a thing, but as soon as you think that's a thing, it turns out to be an activity. Even this table, made of molecules, atoms, ultimately subatomic particles, waves of possibility, it's not a thing, it's an activity. That's why, you know, when the Buddha came out of his cave in the Deer Park, he held a flower, and this known as the famous silent lecture, silent sermon in Banaras, and all the disciples were standing there, they're looking at this flower, which is supposedly a rose, and the only one person, Ananda, who was his favorite disciple, he smiled and the Buddha smiled back. No word was exchanged. And so afterwards, all the other disciples went to Ananda. They said, it seems like you and the Buddha saw something else. We just saw a flower. And Ananda said, I saw a flower, but I also saw rainbows and sunshine and earth and water. I saw the wind. I saw the stars. I saw the galaxies. I saw the infinite void. And I saw myself pretending to be a flower. That was the insight, and no word was exchanged. So the second cause is your grasping and clinging at something that cannot be grasped because it's your own projection. And then it goes. It's sift, S-I-F-T. The third cause of suffering is the fear of impermanence. It's the same thing as the second. Clinging and aversion are complementarities. The fourth cause is identifying with a social construct called the ego, because it's a construct. I am me, but there's no me here. This is an experience in me. And the fifth cause is the fear of death. So this is the five kleshas, the five causes of suffering. And then the summary is that all these five are contained in the first cause, not knowing the difference between the real and the unreal. The unreal is a momentary projection of sift. The real is the awareness in which that momentary projection comes and goes. Okay, so then what's the point of talking about the enlightened brain? What's the point if the brain is also a human construct? And what's the point? Well, the point is that if consciousness or awareness is fundamental, then consciousness conceives, governs, constructs, and becomes what we call everyday reality. Once again, consciousness conceives, governs, constructs, and becomes. Brahman becomes Brahmand. So is the brain real? Well, you know, earlier we were having a discussion in the lunchroom. If I can give you a metaphor, then you might be able to grasp it a little bit more. So, this is water, and water can be steam, water can be ice. I can take the water and make ice cubes out of it, and then I can put other colored water and create images of Hanuman and our gurus, all these. But the fundamental reality of water doesn't change, whether it is the quantum vacuum or whether it is steam or whether it is ice or it is ice cubes with multiplicity of shapes and colors. The fundamental reality stays the same. Similarly, consciousness is mind, consciousness is brain, consciousness is the body, consciousness is the universe. Fundamental reality doesn't change, just like water, steam, ice cubes, statues are all water. The fundamental reality of consciousness doesn't change. So if I damage the brain, I damage the mind. If I damage the mind, I damage the brain, because they are complementary aspects of awareness, of consciousness. There's no contradiction. You hit somebody on the head, you take one mode of experience, and then you interfere with another mode of experience, and then you get coma, which means absence of experience, but not absence of awareness. Awareness never goes away, whether you're sleeping, whether you're dreaming, whether you're in this state, etc. Because without awareness, there is no experience of anything that we call reality. So this word enlightenment has been used a lot, and it's simply the simplest word, again, Vedic word, self-realization, to know oneself. To know oneself, to experience oneself, and from this come many, many aphorisms or principles that all knowledge is structured in consciousness, all experience is structured in consciousness, all reality is structured in consciousness, and therefore every state of consciousness determines its own reality. So last night, when you slept, you had a dream. And when you were dreaming, it was real. You were in the dream. In the morning, you woke up and you said, that was a nice dream. And now we are experiencing this, and we said, no, this is real. The dream was not real. But this is real because we are in it. Okay, if we wake up from this into the presence in which the dream is happening, then this dream is over as soon as it started. You hear that? It's over. So this is what we call the waking dream. And then there was something else that happened last night, which was deep sleep. And we say, there was no experience in deep sleep, right? But actually, if you understand what deep sleep is, it's the closest thing to your real self. Closest thing. When we are in deep sleep, what happens? Subject, object, split disappears. There is only awareness. How do you know there's awareness? Well, if I come and shout at you and say your house is burning, you'll get up and run out of the house, even though you're in deep sleep. Right? If I pinch you, you will get up and say, what are you doing? Okay? So even in deep sleep, awareness cannot go away because awareness is not in time. So actually, deep sleep is closer to your soul, if we want to use that word. By soul, we mean core consciousness with its bundle of karma, memory, desires, which are basically experiences and interpretations of experience. And as long as you're identifying yourself with an experience and the interpretation of experience, that's called the karmic bondage or whatever. But if I have the experience right now, soon fades away, and I don't attach myself to it, I say, I wish I was on that plane, it's going to Bahamas, but I'm already in Bahamas. There's a haiku poem that says, even though I'm in Tokyo, I long for Tokyo. Okay, so it's all experience, as long as you're not attached to the experience, and you cannot actually attach yourself to the experience because it's over as soon as it arises, we create the prison of karma. We create the what we call the baggage of karma. But if you can fully enjoy the experience and let it go because you have no choice, then you're free of karma. Karma is, or karmic bondage is just the attachment that the infinite takes for a certain finite number of experiences. But as you know that you can't hold on to any experience, then, you know, as Rumi in one of his poems says, why do you stay in prison when the door is wide open? Because the prison is self-imposed. And what is the prison? I am this body, I am this mind, this is my possession, this is my ownership. In fact, even your thoughts are not your own. They're just recycling information from everywhere else. Okay, they just go through you. So, here is something from Ramana Maharshi and other great teachers. It's actually, I say Ramana Maharshi, it could be Swamiji, it could be the great gurus here. But in one way or another, they have said this many times, okay? I'm going to summarize it in four principles for waking up right now. The first principle is that know and feel in every moment that the world is a projection of your state of consciousness. This is the projection of your state of consciousness right now, what we call waking consciousness. Number two, recognize that the essential nature of all existence is without ego. Does that tree have an ego, or does anything have an ego? So know at the deepest core of your being that the nature of existence is without ego. Number three, know and feel that you were never born. Everybody here will understand that. But the moment you think you are born, then you have all the problems of old age, suffering, death, which are just experiences in the unborn. That's why in the Gita, Lord Krishna says, fire cannot burn you, wind cannot dry you, weapons cannot shatter you. Water cannot wet you. You are ancient, you are never born, and you're not subject to death. That's what they say, they chant at the cremation. So, number three, live with the conviction that you were never born. Then you have all these problems, constructs, birth, death, old age. These are constructs. Stories around an infinite, unbounded, formless awareness experiencing itself as sensations, images, feelings, thoughts in every moment of now. I shouldn't say moment of now, I should say in every now. Because moment introduces the town. Now is the only presence that never ends. And the last principle, it kind of goes back to the whole idea of neti neti. If you can see it, if you can touch it, if you can imagine it, if you can conceptualize it, if you can think about it, if you can visualize it, if you can taste it, you can smell it, it's not real. Because it's the product of something that cannot be seen, touched, is not in time. The only way for formlessness to experience itself is through interacting with itself and experiencing itself as form. So form is the on-off of the formless interacting with itself. Again, Tagore, you know, poetry is easier always because people have this, T.S. Eliot said, poetry is a raid on the inarticulate. So Tagore says in one of his poems, towards his death, he said, in this playhouse of infinite forms, I caught sight of the formless. And so my life was blessed. Okay. In this playhouse of infinite forms, I caught sight of the formless, and so my life was blessed. The formless, without which there would be no form. Okay, can we remember those four principles? Every moment is a projection of your own self. The essential nature of existence is without ego. You were never born, and you are not your projections. You are the one in whom the projections arise and subside. Can we live with that conviction? Then we have achieved self-realization. Now, of course, there are maps, okay? So one of the maps that we have now is the map that we are getting interested in because the brain records every experience. Remember, the brain is like the ice cube from the quantum vacuum. Okay. There's quantum vacuum, there's particles, there's molecules, and then there's something called H2O, which are human constructs, by the way. And then there's water, there's steam, there's ice, but it's all the time the unmanifest. So the brain is the objective experience of consciousness, as is the body, as is the world, and the mind is the subjective experience of consciousness, but they're all consciousness. But by looking at the brain, we can actually look at the mind. The mind is what is experienced as an object when seen by a third party. If I want to know your mind, I will look at your brain. Because I can't know your mind. Your mind is very personal. But I can look at your brain and I can say the objective correlates of your consciousness in that brain. So the mind is, again, is experiencing itself as the brain. And we can see the correlates of brain. So now these are all the scientific words that, you know, we invented these words for different parts of the brain. Okay, frontal brain, this is here. It's the latest in evolution, and it grew explosively when we started to use language. Language is, and by the way, no one understands. Ask the best evolutionary biologists, how did language come into existence? Nobody can tell you. But, you know, as we were discussing earlier, language maybe is the fall from grace. Okay, language is both divine and diabolical. Because with language, we kind of created this schism, me and God, me and the universe, when there is only one consciousness, differentiating itself as in different knowers, different modes of knowing, different objects known. You can say different seers, different processes of seeing, different scenery. Knower, known, knowing, seer, process of seeing, seeing, observer, observation, observed, all within itself, differentiating into all these species of consciousness, from trees to insects to animals. But by the way, those are, no giraffe knows that it's called a giraffe. But that's a human construct. No dolphin knows it's called a dolphin. That's a human construct. Around what? Sensations, images, feelings, and thoughts. Just as you create your body, you create the giraffe. In the same way, you create a rainbow, a cloud, the universe. Okay. But these are the neural correlates that we can study. Okay, and these have different means. What are neural correlates? They are electrochemical phenomena that we have given to experience, to qualia. How do we know this is electro? Because it's a sensation, image, feeling, thought. That's all it is. But knowing that, we can now look at the mind. And we use the mind to know the mind, ultimately to transcend the mind. So what is neuroplasticity, the new science? It means by changing the ways of thinking, feeling, perceiving, you actually change the brain, which is a projection of your own self. 100 billion neurons with tens of thousands of synaptic connections created by genes and sculpted by experience. Sculpted by experience. We'll do one more meditation later to see how we choose experience. We choose experience just through intention and intention, which are the properties of consciousness. So mindful awareness and meditation are a form of internal experience that promote neuroplasticity. And we can actually, through experience, see which are the correlates. So insula is that small island of tissue which actually houses deep, what you might say, is the neural correlate for the deep wisdom of the body. The body, you've heard the expression, yatha pinde, tatha brahmande. As is the atom, so is the universe. As is the body, so is the universe. As is the atom, so is the universe. As is the mind, so is the cosmic mind. As is the quantum fluctuation, so is this. So this is called recursion. But these are the neural correlates. So deep wisdom, what in Vedanta, or in yoga, with the eight limbs of yoga, yama, niyama, pratyahara. Pratyahara is withdrawal of the senses and then actually going into the deep. Since you're all yogis, you practice bandhas and kriyas and pranayam. All this is getting access to the deep wisdom of your body to access the universal source. And so, but you know, when that is not there, then there also in this, when the connection is lost in the insula, is the representation of disgust, pride, humiliation, lust, and all the things that separate us from existence. And this is now what pratyahara we call in. And so what are the eight limbs? Yama, niyama, which are basically rules of social and personal conduct. And then pratyahara, withdrawal of the senses, going within. And then pranayam, breathing. And then yoga asana. By the way, the word yoga asana literally means seat. Of what? Seat of consciousness, seat of awareness. Yogasana, and then dharana, which is focused awareness, dhyan, which is meditation, samadhi, which is transcendence. We don't need anything more. We understand the limbs of yoga, there's nothing else. But each of these, now this is the scientific word for pratyahara, sensing and regulating activity of internal organs, including heart, lungs, and gut. So let's try something right now. Just close your eyes for a moment. Keep your hands open in your lap. And bring your awareness into your heart. And just for the next minute or so, with focused awareness, become aware of your heartbeat. See if you can bring your awareness into your heart and actually become aware of your heartbeat, either as a sound or a sensation. If that's difficult, then become aware of your heartbeat as an image or even as a thought. And now bring your awareness into your fingertips, in your open hands, and become aware of your heartbeat in your fingertips. And you should be able to feel some throbbing, some sensation, something. And now bring your awareness into your whole body and just know that the same pulse of life is in every cell of your body, in everything in the universe. Okay, relax into your body. Please open your eyes. So how many people could feel their heartbeat? What did you do? Put your attention and have the desire to feel your heartbeat. How many people could feel it in their fingertips? This is a form of pratyahara. Okay, so what scientists are now looking at is they call it interoception, sensing and regulating activity of internal organs, including heart, lungs, and gut. So this is what we do when we do yoga, bandhas, kriyas, pranayam, looking inside, because this is consciousness. Now, scientists today divide our nervous system into what is called sympathetic nervous system and parasympathetic nervous system. So sympathetic is what we call the conscious brain. Conscious brain. Parasympathetic is what we generally call, you know, sympathetic is on overdrive every time you're stressed. Sympathetic goes up and heart rate becomes not variable, it speeds up, adrenaline goes up. These are all constructs which we have created, but nevertheless, there's a correlates of being stressed. And when we are practicing yoga, our parasympathetic nervous system goes up in activity, your heart rate decreases, heart rate variability increases, everything in your biology begins to self-regulate. We just had two papers published, one in Nature Translational Psychiatry and the other in Nature Scientific Reports, which are the highest impact journals, in 1 week of what we did just now, not even adding yoga. We now actually added yoga because yoga increases the stimulation of the vagus nerve, which goes from your brain to your heart, to your lungs, to your gut, influences the microbiome, which is 2.2 million genes that are bacterial. So you have 23,000 human genes and 2.2 million bacterial genes. Technically speaking, we are a few human cells hanging on to a bacterial colony. And what is the bacterial colony? It's the ecosystem of our planet. And what is that? It is carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen. Where did that come from? From stars. In fact, the carbon in your fingernails, the oxygen going to your brain, it could have come from two galaxies, separate galaxies, 2.2 trillion galaxies. Who you are in this form right now is actually stardust becoming self-aware. The dust of stars, the entire universe becoming self-aware through you. So anyway, we published this study, it's now done, and we have more coming on how meditation and yoga changes your gene expression, changes what is called telomerase. In 1 week, the level of telomerase, which is the enzyme that controls your genetic clock, which means how you age, the telomerase went up by 30%. There is no drug that can do that. So we had a collaborator, his name is Eric Schott, he's at Mount Sinai, showed this amazing slide, which I have somewhere, where it shows that in 1 week of meditation practice and yoga, your telomerase goes up by 30%. Your entire genome, 23,000 genes, everything that improves self-regulation goes up, and everything that causes inflammation goes down. And he showed this very beautiful slide with all the pathways and everything. And so somebody in the audience asked Dr. Schott, who's the world's expert on what is called RNA transcriptome, which is how the gene goes through the RNA to express itself as your body. So somebody asked, Dr. Shah, do you meditate? Do you do yoga? He said, no. He said, are you planning to? He said, no. He said, but you just showed us this slide. He said, yes, I'm going to figure out how to make a drug out of this. Okay? So this is not because he's Dr. Shah. He's one of my best friends. I mean, he made us validate yoga and meditation, but that's how they think. That's the training, right? That the correlate is the real thing. The correlate is just a way of measuring the real thing. Okay, but now we can measure everything, and that's good. It helps us talk science to everyone else. So we have three brains. One is called the reptilian brain. If I hold up my hand like this, this is a handy model of the brain. Handy model of the brain. Okay. This is my spinal cord. This is where my thumb is. This is the reptilian brain, which is about 300 million years old. And it's responsible for survival, fight, flight, reproduction, etc. So because of the reptilian brain, we survived as a species. We are a species of consciousness, just like reptiles are a species of consciousness. So that was 300 million years. If I open my hand where you see my thumb is, that's called the mammalian or limbic brain. Mammals are so called because of the word mama, which means breast, mammary, mother, mater, mata, matrika, the mother of creation. And the limbic brain is also called the emotional brain. So we as humans and all mammals, which means rabbits and your cat, everything that is doesn't lay eggs but gives birth to a baby, all mammals, they sing, they play, they make emotional bonds, they experience joy, they experience love, they experience compassion for their own species anyway, but sometimes cross species also. So mammals are an evolutionary outcome of consciousness. And that brain is about 100 million years old. And then the bulk of our brain, this big part of our brain, which is the cortical brain, it is found in mammals, but in humans it grew explosively, particularly with the ability to create language and talk to each other and communicate. So the reptilian brain is for protection, the limbic brain is for emotion, and the cortical brain is for self-reflection, self-realization, and also all the things that go with self-realization, which is unbounded imagination, unbounded creativity, etc. Consciousness by itself is a field of all possibilities. It's a field of creativity. It's a field of correlation. It's where intention comes from. And if the reptilian, limbic, and cortical brain are integrated, then we have a healthy body, healthy mind, healthy spirit, as the experiences that consciousness is having. On the other hand, if you have guilt, if you have shame, if you have mistrust, if you have hostility, of anger, you have fear, then it disrupts the limbic brain. You disconnect from life, and that's how illness begins. All illness begins by disconnecting from your source, which is also the source of everyone else. All illness. Then now we have proof of this. Okay, only 5% of disease-related gene mutations are fully penetrant. So think of DNA as the alphabet of life. Think of genes as the words, and think of your body as a story. Okay, so we have only four alphabets in DNA. A, T, C, and G, we gave those names. Adenine, guanine, cytosine, thymine. But they spell out so many words. These are the genes. And the genes are expressing themselves as your body. And emotional distress of being disconnected from our source, disconnected from each other, it begins disease. And of course, as humans, we have the desire to know, who am I? Why do I want to know? Okay, that's the cortical brain. So everything we did just now, that is actually integrating the three brains. Okay, that's why in Buddhism, they call these divine emotions, love, compassion, joy, and equanimity. Okay, the Sanskrit words for it, but we don't need to go into that. Love, compassion, joy, and equanimity are divine. Why? Because they connect us to each other. They integrate mind, body, spirit, and they connect with the source. They connect with everything else. Okay, that's the limbic brain, and there's a lot more technical stuff there. And the limbic brain is, I shouldn't say the seat of our emotions, it's the neural correlate of emotions. And emotions have the same function as anything else in evolution, which is enhanced survival, but also emotions connected to learning enhance the learning. And that all happens in this part of the limbic brain called the hippocampus. And so, you know, this is too technical, but I want to give you a kind of brief mapping of how consciousness expresses itself as mind and how mind is coded as brain. Brain is third-party way of knowing your mind. Okay. So in the neocortex, and this is very important now because we're going to discuss what is enlightenment, there is the neocortex is what we use to make choice, conscious choices, also consciousness of the body, as in pratyahara. You know, people these days, everywhere you go, you hear the word mindfulness, right? First of all, it's a wrong word. Okay, because the awareness of the mind is not the mind. The awareness of a thought is not a thought. The awareness of a perception is not a perception. So it's a wrong word, but we are stuck with it, so let's accept it. Okay, and awarefulness would be a clumsy word anyway. So, but when we do yoga, what are we doing? We are being aware. I mean, you're not thinking, I hope, of the stock market when you're practicing yoga and breathing and your poses, which are seats of awareness. So yoga is the conduit to awareness, and you are using your cortex. Okay, so when you have consciousness of your body, when you can monitor and regulate your emotions, we can also monitor and regulate the activity of your heart, of your lungs, of your gut. These are very technical aspects of yoga, you know, that advanced yogis do. When you combine that with empathy, interoception, when you stop, and this is a very interesting word that scientists use, GABA-GU. GABA stands for gamma-aminobutyric acid, GU. So when you stop, you observe, you breathe, you proceed with kindness and compassion, your entire brain is flooded with this chemical called GABA. And that's increases parasympathetic activity, which causes self-regulation in the body. Insight, intuition, these are ways of connecting mind, body, and spirit. Okay, these are the three brains, and forget Darwin now for the moment. He's kind of slowly Darwin. People are questioning Darwinian evolution, okay, very slowly, because Darwin, first of all, had no idea about genes, so nobody knew anything about genes. And Darwin's whole thing was, although he didn't use the word survival of the fittest, but that's what it was. And today, at least those of us in the consciousness field, we're saying it's survival of the wisest, not survival of the fittest. Wisdom is the new criterion for evolution, and wisdom is that knowledge which cultivates self-awareness and that which enhances the quality of life. And actually, we can now see the biological correlates of this. And this is where we will go in the future. And we will see the neural correlates of spiritual joy, or what are called peak experiences, even the thrill of scientific discovery, love, compassion, empathy, which all come together as the next stage of our evolution, which brings us closer to the feeling that life is sacred. And so reverence for life, humility, wonder, and and amazement, astonishment, these are spiritual experiences. Rumi says, exchange your cleverness for bewilderment. Sell your cleverness, buy bewilderment, and you will experience the joy of existence. Okay, so we went over this yesterday, but we don't need to go over this. But this is a short history of scientific way view of experience. But for our purposes, when we have limbic regulation, all our biology gets regulated. So internal and external, these are artificial divisions, okay, that we create because we say, I'm squeezed into the volume of my body in the span of a lifetime, and that's outside me, but it's all one. But by creating this and by going through these techniques, body awareness, breath awareness, heart awareness, visceral awareness, awareness of sound, touch, sight, taste, and smell, awareness of images in our consciousness, awareness of our emotions and contemplative practices, and something called metacognition. Metacognition is the ability to observe yourself while you're making choices or while you're having experience. The highest intelligence, which is just being. Just being. Presence. Observing ourselves, having a sensory experiencing, intentional perceptual experience, and self-observation activates the prefrontal cortex. This is the latest in our evolution. Okay, so what is enlightenment? Enlightenment is self-actualization. So now let me give you a little bit of the map, and then we'll take a short break, very short break, 5 minutes. Then Menas will come and join me, and then we can do questions, answers too. And I want to do one more meditation, short one, on observing experience, okay? So here is how one of the maps, no map is absolute, but one of the maps that I learned from my guru, Maharishi Mahesh Yogi, and it comes from the tradition of Shankaracharya. So I've already told you that reality is different in different states of consciousness. Knowledge is different in different states of consciousness. Perception is different in different states of consciousness. As consciousness evolves, reality changes. So the three states of consciousness that we are all familiar with are waking, dreaming, sleeping. Right now, I hope we are all in the waking stage. But it's a waking dream because we think this experience is all there is, right? It's one little drop in the ocean of consciousness. The manifest is one little flicker in the ocean of consciousness. So instead of saying subconscious, we use the word unmanifest. The unmanifest is this manifest experience. So at night, the unmanifest manifests as dreams. Right now, it is manifesting as this experience. Waking, dreaming, sleeping. The fourth state of consciousness, the Sanskrit word of it for it is Turiya, which literally means beyond. So Turiya is actually stepping back from the experience into the presence in which the experience is happening. So all experience right now is happening as witnessing awareness. This experience, this experience, this experience, this experience, this experience. There's a witnessing awareness in which that experience is happening in the form of, easy to remember, SIFT, SIFT. Now turn your attention to that which is having the experience. If I say, be aware. So for a moment, you disengage from the experience into the presence in which experience is happening. That's a momentary glimpse of Turiya, transcendence. It also happens sometimes when people are enjoying music, or they fall in love, or they see a baby, or they see a mountain or the star. We say the beauty of the mountain was breathtaking, time stood still. Okay, so this is a moment of transcendence. If I ask you a simple question right now, this is something that non-dual teachers teach. They say, ask the question, are you aware right now? Who did you consult? Good. Of course, she nodded. I'm aware, right? So now I'm going to ask you, everyone, are you aware? And don't answer the question till I say, till I do this. And then everyone can say yes. Agreed? Agreed? Are you aware? So, are you aware is a thought. Yes is a thought. In between is awareness. Now I ask you the same question. Don't answer it. Just slip into it. Are you aware? So easy. Awareness is the presence which is timeless, formless, giving rise to that experience, all this experience. So one thing you can do, people say, I don't have time to meditate. Usually my response is, if you have don't have time to meditate once a day, then you should do it twice a day, because you really need it. But once in a while, it's not a bad idea to just stop and say, am I aware? Before the seer is overshadowed by the scenery, just stop, ask yourself, am I aware? The presence of being is there, whether you're a child, whether you're a teenager, whether you're having this experience or that experience, it's not in time. Okay, so that is the fourth state. It's called Turiya, or we can say transcendental consciousness. The fifth state is called cosmic consciousness. Cosmic consciousness, it's when the ever-present witnessing awareness is fully awake in waking, dreaming, and sleeping. I'll repeat that. The ever-present witnessing awareness is fully awake in waking, dreaming, and sleeping. So tonight, before you go to sleep, try this following. Before you go to sleep, sit for a few moments in stillness and observe your day. By tonight, this will be a dream. Yes? So observe it on the screen of your consciousness and then say, let it go. It's over. And then just tell yourself, just as I observed my day as a dream, I'll observe my night as a dream. Just say that. See what happens. Maybe nothing, but soon you will find that the witnessing awareness starts to wake up in the dream. And you can witness the body, and you can witness the mind, and you can witness the dream, but you're neither the mind, nor the body, nor the dream. You're the witnessing awareness of the dream that is happening. And then when you wake up in the morning, just recall the dream, if you can. Be easy. But if you are doing yoga, if you are meditating, which you all are, then the ever-present witnessing awareness should be awake in waking, dreaming, and sleeping. What happens with that? This is called being local and non-local at the same time. Local is this experience. Non-local is the awareness in which the experience is happening. So, you know, people, Christian theologian Teilhard de Chardin, used, we are spiritual beings having a human experience. translated into Manas's language, we are non-local beings having a local experience. It means the same thing. So when you can have local and non-local simultaneously, in waking, dreaming, and sleeping, that's in Sanskrit, it's called Thuryatatta. It's beyond transcendence. I am local and non-local. And again, in many religious traditions, they say, I'm in this world, but not of it. So what happens? Each stage of expansion of consciousness, this is expansion of awareness, leads to different insight, different intuition, different way of interpreting the world, different way of experiencing the world, slowly going in the direction where the Buddha saw the whole universe in a rose, or in a leaf, or in a cloud, or anywhere. So in Thuryatatta, first of all, there's more intuition, more creativity, more imagination, more power of intention, more synchronicity. Synchronicity means tapping into non-local correlation where everything is connected with everything else. So what we call coincidences, many coincidences happening all at the same time. You say, what's happening? You know, it's very unusual. I have a thought and suddenly the thought starts to manifest. I thought of someone and they called me on the phone. I thought of chocolate ice cream and somebody brought me chocolate ice cream. What is happening? Well, you're tapping into non-local mind, which is correlating everything into everything. Okay, so now with this experience comes the loss of the fear of death, because you realize that death doesn't happen to you. Death happens to the birth and arising and subsiding of sensations, images, feelings, and thoughts. That one particular lifetime is a qualia program built around karma, memory, desire, to which we attached. But if we could enjoy it and let it go, then there's no karma involved. Karmic freedom is less than a thought away. Because between the question and the answer, am I aware? Between this thought and this thought is freedom. As long as you shift your awareness to that. Okay, so no death anymore. That's called cosmic consciousness, Thuryatatta. Sixth state of consciousness is called God consciousness or divine consciousness, or what you can say, the Sanskrit word for this is, you can use many words, but it's basically divine darshan of God, in that the ever-present witnessing awareness is not only present in you, the subject of experience, but in also the objects of experience. That's God consciousness, that sound, that plant. So there is a witness here, there's a witness there. And when the witness here and the witness there can commune, that's called divine consciousness. According to our great teachings, this is the realm of miracles. Because you no longer see yourself as a person. The person is a process in consciousness. And no longer see other objects as things. That's also a process in consciousness, and it's the same consciousness. But I'm still, there's some duality, right? The consciousness here, the ever-present witnessing awareness here, the ever-present witnessing there, but there is some communion. Not communication, communion. It's holy communion. It's called Bhagavat Chetna. Sixth state of consciousness. And then the seventh state of consciousness is called Brahmi Chetna. And that is that the witness here and the witness in all objects of experience, because for me, I'm the subject of experience, or I think it's somewhere here, and you are the object of experience. But when all the witnessing awareness, all knowers of awareness, the ever-present witnessing awareness in me and the ever-present witnessing awareness in you, they become one, then there's only one witness, and this whole universe is the manifestation of that universe. So now it's even beyond God consciousness, because Brahman consciousness or unity consciousness. But there is still witness, right? There's witness and there is the whole universe. When even the witness dissolves, that's pure consciousness. Each stage of consciousness can be accessed through the practice of yoga, if you understand the totality of yoga. Because yoga is the progressive quietening of qualia into the source of qualia. Each state is possible. And so each state progresses, includes the previous state, but it also transcends the previous state. So this is some kind of mapping. Now, why is it important? Because we as scientists, or we who think we are scientists, you know, we have a program now to look at the brain in all these states of consciousness. People are having these experiences around the world. There's some awakening. So you can see what the brain is doing and you can map it. Okay, that's the gift of science. If we use it correctly, we can then create biological correlates of consciousness. And actually, then by actually looking at the brain, we can say that the subjective experience correlates with the objective correlates. We have a program right now to look at that. You know, over here in Bahamas is the home of the Templeton Foundation. I don't know how many people are aware of that, but Sir John Templeton lived here. He dedicated his life to the understanding of spirituality and science. So I actually met with some of their board members, and they're very interested in non-local mind. So the first experiment we're going to do is we have identified what are called savants. Savants, you know what savants are? These are these little children. Sometimes they have autism and all, but they are mathematical geniuses, or they are musical geniuses, and or they can tap into non-local mind. They can predict what's happening tomorrow before it happens. Or they have what we call telepathy. So we have identified a few of these children who are tapping into non-local mind, because your normal brain is editing out everything. Normal brain is the hypnosis of social conditioning, or we would say karmic bondage. Okay, but when you stop engaging with the karma, then you have access to the non-local mind. And so all these things, waking, dreaming, deep sleep, soul consciousness, transcendental consciousness, non-local and local consciousness, divine consciousness, unity consciousness, ultimately pure consciousness. We can talk about progressive stages of waking up, but we can also say how to be instantly awake all the time by shifting. Okay, thank you.